This is Tracy Hales Vass, right on Four Corners on KSJE 90.9 FM in Farmington, New Mexico. Today, I'm talking to Dr. Misty Carty from Little Science about her books, Where is the Moon? And others. We'll be giving a presentation at the Aztec Public Library on July 9th, titled A Universe of Stones. Hi, Misty.
Hi, Tracy.
I'm so glad to talk to you. I enjoyed your little book, Where is the Moon?
Thank you so much. I'm happy to be talking to you, too. I'm glad you enjoyed it.
I did. Now, tell me a little bit about what A Little Science is.
Oh, my. A Little Science is a company that I started a few years ago and have been running ever since. It started out as a way for me to publish my children's science books. I had trouble finding a publisher who was be interested in children's books, especially young children's books. So we're talking preschool age or even younger, that solely had photographs in them and not drawings or illustrations. And because a lot of times they're for books that young, they expect there to be an illustrator attached to a book. Not just an author, yeah. the landscape of that is starting to change a little bit, especially through the National Science Teachers Association, some of their books that they have coming out. But back when I started, that was kind of an unknown realm to have photographs only. And so I started the company so I could publish my books, and it's grown a lot since then. I found going out on my own, having to do venues, author events, which I found I really liked doing, particularly if I got to do story times and do presentations.
Yes.
I really like interacting with the kids and seeing their eyes light up.
Right.
When I explain something and they see something for the first time or maybe in a different way that they had never been exposed to it. And so, so from there, it's actually grown into kind of an outreach program, getting to go out into the communities to do lots of story times and presentations. And also, in doing that, I've had lots of feedback from families looking for science that they can do at home with their kids, either for homeschool or over the summer, or just extracurricular outside of regular school hours. So I've started doing some science kits as well, and getting them out to places and stuff. Yeah, so my books are for sale in a few museums around New Mexico, as well as my science kits. And then I go out into libraries and museums and do presentations. So for the kids.
And you have three of the books out now. Why are their seasons? Where did the sun go? And where is the moon? Right?
That's correct, yeah.
And what is the science kit?
So the two types of science kits that I have right now are, one is a scale of the solar system that kids get to turn into a key fob. So I like to tell kids my superpower, especially since like Marvel movies are really popular right now. Kids are really into superheroes.
Right.
I always like to tell them my superpower is math.
All right.
And so, yeah. I get some looks sometimes when I say that, but they like it. They tend to laugh along. So I tell them I shrunk the whole solar system so they could take it with them on their backpack. And all of the beads are exact size scaled to one another. So Jupiter's still 11 times as big as the Earth, but you get to fit them all on one key fob. So the distances aren't accurate,
right?
But the different sizes of the planets are. Yeah, and they get to put it all together. I've found, especially for a lot of libraries have steam labs or steam room type areas for their kids to come in, and their local community kids to come in and have some hands-on science. And it's kind of popular with those areas and those places because the kids get to they're seeing the scale, and they're also using their hands and manipulating everything.
Right.
And then the other ones are more fun. They're still science, but in a more kind of artsy way. There's my kids, personally. I have an 8-year-old and a 6-year-old. They really got into their perler beads, their melty beads. Mm-hmm. And so I started taking NASA Hubble images and designing, of Saturn, a design with the beads that they get to melt then. And then they get all kinds of information along with the kit, not just the beads and stuff like that, but they get all kinds of, this is the image, and here are some fun facts, and the image was taken with Hubble, and things like that.
Exciting. So you'll be there doing a universe of stones at the Aztec Public Library on July 9th.
Yeah. So I'm really fortunate this summer. The National Summer Reading Program is space themed.
Right.
And so all of the state public libraries are participating in a universe of stories. And so it's, starting, for most of them, it's starting very early June and going through early August. They'll be having programs and programming, presentations, story times that are space related. And so I fit right in. We're going to be touring around Mexico, getting to go to all these different state public libraries. One of them is Aztec on July 9th, which I'm super excited about. And for them, we're actually going to be learning about our cosmic address, so where we fit in the universe, where the Earth is, and taking that and kind of my twist on it is, most kids are used to learning how to write down their physical address, where their home is, or even where their school is, and taking that and extrapolating it to let's write down where we are in the universe.
And what age group are you shooting at?
So my youngest book, which is Where is the Moon, it's designed for pre-K and up. But mm-hmm. even if you had a younger kid who was really interested, say even reading to your children, I'm a huge person behind the movement to start reading to your children as young as possible.
Right,
it's one of those books that you could even read to your youngest kids. So the books are kind of geared from pre-K up through middle school, with the oldest book being Why Are There Seasons.
I know that you sort of took off from the Goodnight Moon theme to write Where Is.
Yes, I did. Yeah. So my books are all inspired by my kids. I took off. I was a professor of physics and astronomy before writing the books,
mm-hmm.
and I decided to take off time to be with my family. My youngest daughter, she was 2 at the time, and Goodnight Moon was her favorite book at the time,
right.
Which is one of the really popular ones. And she wanted to go to the moon to say goodnight to it. She wanted to go to the window, to say goodnight to the moon. And we did, but the moon wasn't there.
Right.
And so she said, "Where is the moon?" And I thought,
well.
I think I should do something with that. Yeah. So she actually helped out with taking the picture. So we set out, and it was October when we did this. I believe it was October of 2013 or 2014,
mm-hmm.
And we set out, and she helped me. We took pictures of the moon every night from our house, and starting right after new moon. So we actually saw, and we went out at the same time,
mm-hmm.
At night, right before bed, and so she got to participate in helping me get the photographs that are actually in the book. So,
and that's great. It's great the way it shows that the moon is always there, but in a different way.
Yeah, it's a different spot, yeah, and I think for a lot of kids, even adults too, you let them know the moon is up during the day, and they're a little taken aback sometimes,
right.
and I think it's fun, even from a young age, to show them that you can do this. You can actually go out and say, I have a question, and where is the moon, and I can look for it, and I can do the science behind it. And then they can find out, I have to get up in the morning now,
right,
instead of
right.
at night to go see it. So,
do you have something you can read for us?
Sure. I could read the first few pages. It might be, I was thinking about this, it might be a little hard because of the not having the pictures.
Right, right.
But yeah, I can describe when necessary, okay, for the pictures.
That's great.
Sure. The title is Where is the Moon? And it starts out, every night before bed, I read my new favorite story, Good Night Moon. Then I say goodnight to the moon from my window. Good night, moon. And we see the moon on October 1st, and it's really low just above the houses in the eastern part of the sky. And the next night, we say good night, moon, on October 2nd, and it's risen a little bit higher. And the next night on October 3rd, we say good night, moon, and it's even higher still. And then the October 4th, we say good night, moon, and it's the highest that we've seen it so far. And I see the moon in a different spot each night. Good night. Wait, where is the moon? I cannot see the moon from my window. Mommy and I go outside to explore. We look up and we see the moon. It is much higher in the sky. I can see almost half of it. Good night, moon, I say. Now, each night before bed, I go outside with Mommy to say good night to the moon. And so the idea behind all of it is that the kids, even with just a little bit of help from an adult, can go through the process. And at the end of the story, there's a section for parents and educators to tell them, show them how to go through and actually take their kids to go do that. And then also more facts about the moon and why we see the phases of the moon so they can answer further questions from their kids. So
it's difficult for them sometimes, I think, to get the concept of the moon as a separate entity. And this really helps them start understanding, well, space.
Yeah, so a cool thing I didn't actually set out to do when I started writing the books. This was, like I said, I was inspired by my daughter for this one, and this one was one of the very first ones. But they're all aligned with our science standards here in New Mexico and the national science standards. So one of the very first things, especially for K through second, is one of their major science standards is for noticing changes. And so a lot of one of the go-to ones is changes in the moon, changes in the night sky. Mm-hmm. And so I think this book helps launch that a little bit, even if you start at a younger age.
Right.
So.
Where can people get these books?
That's an excellent question. So they are for sale at Amazon and Barnes & Noble.
Okay.
They're online. They're also for sale in our Barnes & Noble here in Albuquerque at the Coronado Mall.
Okay.
They are for sale at several museums around New Mexico. They're at the Natural History Museum and Science and here in Albuquerque. They're at the International Balloon Museum. They're at the Children's Museum in Santa Fe, and then also at the Bradbury Science Museum in Los Alamos.
Great. For the hands-on presentation, so is there a fee charge for people to go there?
No, so that is free and open to the public for them to come.
Great.
On July 9th. And it's at 2 p.m.
Okay.
On July 9th, yeah. Yeah, so people can contact the library. They can contact me, too. I'll have it posted. So I'm on Facebook and Instagram and Twitter, all under A Little Science. And I'll have it posted on Facebook as well and have the event tied in to Aztec's Facebook page.
Great. And it's alittlescience.com is the website.
Yeah, that's my website. And the links for the books are on there. My summer schedule is there because I've been going around. I'm going up to Aztec. I'm going all the way down to Alamogordo.
Wow, that's
we're
great.
We're going everywhere this summer.
that's really exciting. So what you were professor of what?
Of physics and astronomy.
You have your PhD.
Yeah, so for my education, I got my bachelor's degree in physics, and then I went on to get my master's and my PhD in astronomy, and was a professor after that.
And where did you teach?
So I taught for a little while at McKendree University in Illinois, and then also for a short time in Arlington, Virginia at Marymount University.
So what is it like switching from teaching college students to working with young kids?
Oh, that's a great question. So one of the interesting things I found when I was teaching college was that you're getting people who have, you've got young teenagers through their early 20s, students in general, and they've got kind of an idea of who they are and where they think they're going in their life. And so for a lot of them, when we were teaching introductory astronomy, it was hard if it wasn't a majors class, it was a little difficult for them kind of to maybe really get into it, I think, or to let themselves get into it, because it wasn't necessarily what they were there to major in. It was an elective,
right,
or a requirement,
right.
So one of your goals always was to try to find ways to be really engaging and make it interactive to catch them, to get them interested.
Right.
I think the big difference is that with children, they're so curious. They're so young and so new still that
right.
they have no sense of who they are really. They're still figuring all of that out. And so, if they think the moon's cool, then they think the moon's cool and they're going to pay attention to you. They're natural scientists on their own. And I love with kids too, because, there's, especially even with our girls, they don't really seem to have any hang-ups as far as, like, what is maybe they might have been told who, science is, for boys or something
right.
like that.
Right.
They don't have that yet. And so you can really get in there and get them excited and help them, keep that excitement going in case they do run into those types of hurdles when they're older.
That's really true, because there has been stigmas against women in science.
There have been, yeah. That was so when I was majoring in physics, I went to a small liberal arts college in Maryland,
mm-hmm.
and I was the only girl in a lot of my physics classes.
Wow.
I was very, at the time, I had enough momentum from just really loving physics and loving science that it didn't bother me. And when I got to graduate school, my class was actually predominantly female. There was there were eight of us, and only one student out of the eight was actually male. The rest of us were all female.
Oh, there you go.
and that was great, having that camaraderie and actually having that. I didn't know that I had missed that when I was an undergrad until I got to graduate school. There's still stigmas. A lot has changed. I mean, I left back academia almost 10 years ago now. And then it was, having children was not exactly something that you wanted, was advised of you to do
right.
if your goal was to go on to get tenure and be a professor. And I made the choice to stop and actually have my family and everything. But I'm really glad that I did, because I feel like I'm reaching more people now, and I feel like I'm going out of, those bounds necessarily that people try to say science has to be in, and I, just reaching the community and really, helping uplift teachers and librarians and stuff. I love that part of it.
Yes.
So.
And you, like you said, you're reaching them at a younger age and probably giving them a greater influence into the sciences.
Yeah, I was really inspired a couple summers ago. We had the total solar eclipse that went across the continental United States.
Right.
And I was fortunate that I got to participate in what was called the Eclipse Mega Movie, which was spearheaded by both Google and Berkeley.
Oh.
And so what they did was, that's actually where all the pictures for my book, Where Did the Sun Go, came from. So they gathered citizen scientists from across the continental United States who were going to be in the path of totality, and to educate them on how to properly take eclipse photos with a DSLR or a mirrorless camera, and so that we could study the sun's corona for that duration that the sun, as the path of totality, went from the west coast to the east coast. And so there's actually a movie that they made out of it, and it's really cool getting to see how the images change as you go from coast to coast. And I was really inspired by them because they put, it was also the Astronomical Society of the Pacific was heavily involved, and they just really put so much effort into getting the community and getting out there and getting as many people as possible for this one science event. And and they're going to do it again. And I just, they really got me involved in getting out there to educate about the eclipse. And then I loved it. So kind of kept going.
How exciting. I like that you said citizen scientists.
Those two words really struck me because I feel like that's what I do. I feel like I help encourage everyone to understand that they can be a scientist themselves, and they don't need, especially with the books, like, you know, they can have a little guidance and then actually, you know, go out and do the science.
Exactly.
So, and participate.
Yes. So are you, what's the next book?
So the next book is actually tied in with the presentation I'll have at Aztec on July 9th. So the presentation title is Our Cosmic Address, but the book title is going to be What is Our Cosmic Address?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, and I've had the very fortunate, I keep saying that word, but I really love what I do because I have my fingers in lots of little pots doing lots of different things. So I've been working with local Albuquerque public schools, and one of the things we've been doing is there is a NASA-backed program called the Sally Ride Earth Cam, and it is a camera that's aboard the International Space Station, and it's an educational camera for students that are in K through 12 to request images of the Earth from space.
Oh, okay.
So it's a camera. Yeah, it's up in one of the windows. It's right next to the astronauts. We tie in, especially now that Google has their ISS maps. Like, you can actually see what inside the International Space Station and stuff. So we show children that. I've been working with lots of different age groups in elementary school taking pictures. And I thought, wow, this is so cool. We actually got a picture of Albuquerque from the International Space Station. And I thought, you know, this ties in so well with the What is Our Cosmic Address that I just felt like I needed to make a book with it. And so I show that picture when I do the presentations around here. So I'm going to be helping out a lot at the New Mexico Natural History Museum here in Albuquerque for doing, they just started up a science story time that's every second and fourth Tuesday of the month. So I'll be doing a bunch of those too. Be busy, yeah. But I still get to be at home most of the time, which is great. So
that works out really well. So do you think that eventually you'll go back to teaching? I meant institution.
In a formal capacity.
Right.
I have looked into it, and I have thought about going back, maybe teaching like community college and stuff. I do worry, touching back on that whole stigma thing that we talked about before. Like I said before, I haven't taught at an post-secondary level in almost 10 years now, and I'm not exactly sure that most institutions would see what I'm doing as a way. Yeah, I worry that they wouldn't see that what I've been doing is actually great post-secondary, even though I think it would be so beneficial even for those ages to just be presented the material in a different way. Yeah.
Right. Like you say, hands-on. So.
Yeah. A lot of the reasons why I photographed the images the way I did is because I was used to teaching them from textbooks that show them in a very different way.
Right.
And I think the different view is really important. So especially with the seasons, a lot of times we show as professors the analytum, which is the height of the sun changing throughout the year.
Mm-hmm.
If you took a picture at the same time throughout the year, every about a month and a half. I think the problem with that is we usually use a solar filter, which is important. You want to use a solar filter. You don't want to look at the sun.
Right.
But it's not really what we see because we don't see through a solar filter.
Right.
And then also those images, usually the one image that they have that they place because it's a composite image,
mm-hmm.
That they place the analytum on, it's not showing you the really important part behind the tilt of the Earth and the fact that the height of the sun is changing is that the length of the shadows are changing.
Right.
So that sunlight is getting spread out. Yeah. So that's
exciting.
It's a different view.
Right. your website is alittlescience.com, and you'll be at the Aztec Public Library July 9th at 2 p.m.
Yes, that is correct.
All right. Well, thank you so much for talking to me.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been wonderful talking with you.
It's been great. And that was Misty Carty talking to us from Albuquerque about her books in the A Little Science series and her presentation at the Aztec Public Library, July 9th at 2 p.m. This is Tracy Hales-Vass, right on Four Corners on KSJE 90.9 FM in Farmington, New Mexico.